it's the love that I feel during the dark times. You know what I mean?
Hey, listen, I invited you back on.
Thank you so much.
That's love right there. I think you're probably going to get you a printer or something.
Yeah. Yeah, that Percocet's going to go over real big.
Real big. That's okay. You can handle it. You're a big boy. But we're mixing it up tonight a little bit. We're bringing some of the guests that we had in the past on, and I could not pass up to ask Coach Ben to come back on. Because it's been weeks since you've been on here. You've had a lot of stuff going on.
I do. A lot of things going on. First of all, I had my right knee replaced, which, listen, I had 5 knee surgeries back when I was playing. They'd say, oh, you're out 5 weeks. I'd be like, bullshit, I'll be back in 3. You're out 10 weeks. I'm like, no, I'll be back in 7. This one, I said, you'll be good in 4. I'm like, no, it's going to be more like 10. This thing is killing me. I got range of motion back in it and all the things you're supposed to do. But man, this thing hurts worse than all of the other 5 put together.
Especially the physical therapy that you have to do where you're going to push down.
Well, listen, I've been through physical therapy for 30 years while I was playing. That's a given. You know that that's going to hurt. You know that you have to do it. And it hurts. Make no mistake, it hurts. This one is like, oh, by the way, you're not 28 anymore. So let's throw the hurt and the ache in there just to let you know that you're not a whippersnapper.
I'm lucky. I haven't had my wife had taught a new replacement surgery, so I know what you're going through her.
Well, a lot of people will say afterwards, oh, it's the greatest thing in the world. Tell me that in your first 3 weeks, I will call you a liar and smack you with a mackerel. There is zero chance that anybody else has felt good after a couple of weeks of this thing. It takes a while, and it ain't pretty, but the light at the end of the tunnel hopefully is not a train coming by way.
Words of experience right here. It'll be good.
It's a very deeply introspective.
It'll be good. You'll be able to walk.
Happy birthday to Carla. Happy birthday to Carla. Carla is one of many of our season ticket holders, frequenters of the Fish on Fire experience up here.
Happy birthday, Carla.
It's her 21st.
This microphone here isn't working as good as that one here. Yours is good. I'll let you do a lot of those, all the talking.
And that's the way it should be, Pat.
Sure, I know. Hey, but Ben, you know, a lot of stuff has gone down in the last couple of weeks. We've had the Albany team coming in here.
Sure.
We'll see Ron and Nate versus the Albany team.
Which, right.
Name will be announced in the near future, I'm sure. But then we just had Baltimore out now. They're not in, correct?
You know, I don't really know the ins and outs. Our ownership would probably have to address that. Funny you should mention Albany, because I understand that the ownership in Albany is paying really, really well. So in addition to having my name in the hat for Orlando, which at this point really hasn't been looking that good, I dropped my name in the hat for Albany because those dudes up there are paying. And, you know, listen, arena football is arena football, whether it's here in Orlando or whether it's up in Albany, New York. We're all just going to have a good time.
Yeah. They know you're injured right now. Do the people in Albany know that you're injured?
Listen, I'm coming off the IR in 6 weeks. I got plenty of time to get ready for the season.
You say 6, they say 10. You just, you know, live with it.
Tomato, tomato, potato, cucumber. Who knows?
Exactly. But, let's see, we had the commissioner on.
The commish! Chris Siegfried.
2 weeks ago, yeah, 2 weeks ago we had the commissioner on. And we threw some questions at him as far as, like, the fans want to know. I want to know your perspective on it. Fans want the Nets back. What are your thoughts on having the Nets come back?
You know, there's good and bad. The Nets were part of the original systems, and it adds a lot of excitement to the game. Not having the Nets behind on either side of the uprights, it's one of those things where if you kick it through, you get 2 points, you start back. You know, there's some strategy there. I personally like the Nets because that goes back to old-time arena football. But bigger than that, the problem with the Nets or the benefit of the Nets, I was coaching a team in Milwaukee my very first year. We got the ball first. We had to kick a long field goal. They touchdown. We didn't touch the ball again until the second quarter. They got five balls in a row off the net. So we were down 35 to nothing before we got the ball back. You know, so anything can happen with those nets. But, you know, it's neither here nor there. And a lot of it, I think, in my opinion, has to do with player safety. Players don't have to turn their backs on eight guys running down trying to kill them. And you know, you catch that thing and turn around. It's like Jumanji. You have no idea what's coming at you. So.
That's that, you know what? When we had Herky Walls on, he was saying he loved that part. He only had to worry about five of the guys because he knew his team would take care of him.
Herky, he lied about liking the Nets. Herky was so terrified of getting hit. If he could have stayed in the stands and danced, I give Herky a bad time. He's a great player and a great guy. And once he got going forward, if we picked up a few blocks, boy, he would fly through and he'd get down there and dance like nobody's business because he was pretty good at it. Now, if there were people in front of him, Herky was, what's the guy's name? David Copperfield. He can make an elephant disappear in the middle of a crowded room.
So he would disappear as he'd defenders in front of him trying to get
him. Yeah, listen, but he did it gracefully, though. Give him credit. And what was that you were asking about me putting my name in the hat for Albany? Yes, from what I understand, the Albany owners, boy, they are really opening the purse strings up there because they want things to be done right. So, I, because I care about the goodness of the game, have put my hat in the ring at Albany. Still love Orlando, really do. Mean it sincerely. Oh, hey, Ron, what's up? Great to see you. Sorry, one of the owners is here.
Yes, one of the owners is here tonight. The others should be here as well. So
he's heading to his new South Fork Ranch. He got himself new digs out there. It's beautiful. Really, really pretty.
Yeah, out there in Estatuto. I don't know. It's Lake County.
I just know it's Lake County.
But it's going to be prettier when they get everything done. And you'll be moved in. And hopefully we'll have an opening party for it. Hey, listen, if you guys have a question for Coach Ben Bennett, call it in. The number's going to be on the screen in just a second, but I'll throw it out there, 407-595-1179. Ask head coach of the Orlando Predators at the period here at this time. Albany could be later on. We'll find out. But if you have any questions for Coach Ben Bennett, give us a call.
Or if they want to talk to me directly, they can call my pay-per-view lines, 1-900-BIG-STUD. Feel free to call as many times as you like. Regular text of great supply.
So that's perfect sets that you're taking?
It should be. I got a whole bottle of goodness waiting at the house I haven't touched yet, but get closer.
Mark Rowley's been coming out there. He says it's stuck here on Facebook. Did you see that IT? Just make sure you can see it on there. I don't know how the feedback is for on Facebook Live.
Listen, I got Berkey to turn his head. If Burke turns his head, that means everybody in the building can hear me.
That's in the building. We want to make sure people out there, the fans out in Facebook land, can hear you as well. Ben, what about Iron Man? That was brought up to the commissioner as well. What are your thoughts on Iron Man?
Well, again, it's like the Nets. There's pros and cons to either way. The Iron Man game was how the game originated. What you did was you had a bunch of guys that played in the NFL, the USFL, the Canadian League, that were very position specific. You had ADB, and that's all he did was he played DB. You had a wide receiver, and that's all he did. You had a guard, and that's all. Well, what arena football opened up for a lot of people was the Barry Wagners of the world. The guy who, at the NFL level, is probably not fast enough to run by a lot of people on the outside of wide receiver. He wasn't quite big enough that he could do damage at a tight end position. But he was just a great football player. And you put him on the field and give him the ball, or put the ball somewhere near him, he's going to make things happen. And so that's what happened. You would get the guy that was a really good pass rusher who, for one series of quarter, could turn around and pass for 10. And the substitution rules is what really gave him a bite. Because you say, okay, in theory, I'm going to start my best offensive two-way player, let him play one series on offense. Then my best defensive player at the two-way position, he's going to play defense, and then maybe offense. Well, if you had a longer drive, you take that guy out, you stick him back in, now of a sudden there's a turnover, there's an injury, there's this, that, and the other. And because of the substitution rules, that same dude has to play the rest of the quarter.
Right.
And if somebody gets hurt, that same guy has to play the rest of the game. And I mean offense, defense, and special teams. That's why they coined it the Iron Man, because those dudes never left the field.
And the fans won that back. I mean, that would just wear somebody out to where I personally don't want the Iron Man to come back, because I like fast pace, everybody's fresh, offense in, defense in, and, you know, swap players out. Iron Man kind of nulls that, doesn't it?
Yes and no, but you're talking about a different type of player. The guy that will play and happily play both ways for almost an entire game, that's a dude who wants to be on the field, and he's going to bust his rear end to make sure things happen. Now, when the Arena League went away from the Iron Man rules, was when the NFL started flexing their muscles and said, we want to be involved. Well, that's great. Give us money, give us support, then you can start changing it. We had Ron Jaworski come in, we had all these grand plans to be an NFL subsidiary, and the NFL never did anything. And so now we went from the guys that were playing both ways and all the substitution rules. It was just back to it's an outdoor game, but it's played indoors. So the arena football purists would like to have Iron Man back. I would love to have Iron Man back. But however they lay it out, we're going to go out, we're going to win games, we're going to have a lot of fun, so I don't really care either way.
Oh, that, yeah. Now, I noticed on TV, on Facebook and on Twitter, Instagram, everything, you know, all these other different social media things that other teams are signing players already. The so-and-so has been re-signed, What can you tell us about some of the players that we had signed for the 2020 season?
Going back in. So I ran back out of there. About three seen on the film, I threw it, the camera starts panning downfield, but you can see Wilcher come around. He hit me again, another cheap shot, and he cracked two of my ribs. So I go off to the sideline, and if you've ever had cracked ribs, imagine somebody putting an ice pick into your lungs every time you take a breath. Not even close to what that feels like. The emotion, the adrenaline, Carolina, Duke, my buddies, whole bit. I told a freshman, I said, give me your rib pad. And he's like, what? I said, take your stuff off right now. Give me your rib pad. I throw him back on, and as my trainer, who had just told me I was out of the game, he's going over to the van to get ice. I'm running back out of the field, pulling my shoulder pads on over these rib pads as he's screaming, no, no! So I go back out, we finish the game, we beat him 23-17, first time we beat him in 10 years. It took the better part of 6 weeks before that type of pain subsided. And cracked ribs is not something that I would wish on anybody. It was brutal. Now, besides the fact that I've been knocked out of concussed 13 times, so my senior year, we're playing Virginia Tech. Virginia Tech had a little-known defensive tackle named Bruce Smith. Bruce Smith, not a bad little country ball player, but nobody knew who he was. Well, second quarter, he gets me, knocks me, slap out. I thought I was in the huddle, and I was standing on the sidelines. I'm like, hey, like, how did I? Because I was literally just in the game, and I was in the huddle, and all of a sudden, I'm on the sidelines. Well, nobody knew I was knocked out. So I'm like, all right, so we come up with this plan to block Bruce Smith. We're going to help with this guy, and this guy's going to help a little bit. We get into the fourth quarter, and we're still in a pretty close ball game. We have this grand blocking scheme. Bruce Smith runs around the whole thing. And as I'm getting ready to throw it, I got hit in the back of the head. If you've ever seen the movie The Professional with Natalie Portman when she was little, when the bomb goes off and he gets shot in the back of the head, he just starts going like this, everything turns yellow. And that was me. And I hit the deck. It was the hardest I've ever been hit. And for some stupid reason, the only thing I could think of, my father had told me since I was a kid, which is don't ever let him see you hurt. Get up and go back to the huddle. So in my mind, I said, get up and go back to the huddle. My legs were like, zero chance of that. And I looked like a drunken sailor at 3 in the morning. My leg, some guy catches me and says, holding me up, says, why don't you just wait here for your train? I said, that's a hell of an idea. Now, I didn't know until the next day that A, it was Bruce Smith that had knocked me out. But B, when I started falling over, he's the one that caught me and said, wait for your train. And just, it told me a lot about the kid. First, that he was a tremendous player. But what a class act. He could have watched me fall, stood over me, done anything in the world. But for the second time in the day, he knocked me out. And instead of look, he helped me up. So
that's a class act.
Those are a couple of them.
That was from that question was from Adam Claw.
Oh yeah.
So if the fans ever didn't catch that. I don't know how that technical difficulty there, but I got other questions on here. Tom Trigger wants you to bring back LJ Castillo as a wide receiver.
He played with us a little bit in 2019, I think.
Yeah, last night.
And LJ is a really, he's a nice kid, and he's a really good receiver. But this league, as much as I'd like to keep a lot of guys around, this has become a young man's league. There's a lot of really, really young players that are just dying to get out there and prove themselves. And I think that's kind of the direction of the league.
Take your water.
No, I won't be drinking any water. I'm drinking cranberry juice.
Oh, it's good.
Yeah, that's
good.
What I'm drinking.
Yeah.
And my girlfriend is Morgan Fairchild.
Yeah, that's it. Oh, there we go.
And my one of my other business partner, Nate, just sent me a text and said, hey, let's sign some players. I'm like, yeah, that's a great idea. Let's sign a head coach.
I heard Rob Key was available. I'm just saying, rumors get out there.
I'm a predator for life. I'm a head coach for life. He's won a lot of ball games. Very enthusiastic guy. And I wish he and Les Moth, I wish you both the best.
Dig about the game. Exactly. I mean, it's non-stop excitement, and
stands, you get to keep them. If one of the players goes in the stands, you have to give them back.
No, which brings me to a comment I had. I did a guest spot there on Second Favorite TV over at Ace Cafe.
Right.
And shout out to Second Favorite TV for hosting us tonight here at Amazon. Our lighting and our mics and everything here. But Jean B. Martin, and she is a front row season ticket holder since day one.
Right.
And she said how one time she caught herpes balls in the end of her seat, and she did not want to. She kept hold of it, didn't want to let him go.
Well, herpes little enough, she probably could have carried them all in her purse.
She was didn't want to let him. She tossed it all back and wanted to keep herpes.
Herpes a good guy. He was a big part of what we did. He was a big part of the foundation that we laid towards, you know, being what we eventually became. You know, there's a lot of guys. Barry Wagner, Jerry Odom, Paul McGowan, Henry Brown, Wendy Burnett, you know, Billy Owens. You go down the line. There's just so many. Derwin Rockmore, Tony Scott, Carl Akins. There were just so many guys that put a lot of time and effort into making this franchise Orlando's favorite. And you can talk about the Magic, and they're fantastic, and they're an NBA team. We were a way harder thing to get way back then than the Magic.
I'm
going with it.
Yeah, I know it is. And
most of the stuff I say on here factually, I just made up. So if you actually research any of the quotes that I have, you'll probably find that I'm erroneous. But they sound really good, because what I do is when I tell you a fact, I will enunciate, I will speak louder, and I'll move my hands a lot. So even if it's not true, you will think that it's factual.
You see there, lesson learned, folks.
No, I'm sorry, no questions. Question to me? Go ahead.
Do you have a question?
Hi, I just looked up on here.
Yeah,
I'm playing for the Cowboys.
Yep.
Browns.
No, Cowboys. The Houston Oilers, which will tell you how old I am. The Atlanta Falcons, the Cowboys, the Bengals, and the Bears.
What's your coaching experience?
I've coached a little bit in the AFL, the AF2, and then I coached back at Duke for almost three seasons. So I've got a little bit of pro experience, a little bit of college experience. I can coach anywhere. I'm comfortable in the Arena League because I've done it for so long. The bigger plus for me is I got to call my own plays and put together my own personnel group for many, many years. So for me, this is just natural. It's just something I've done for a long time, and I feel really comfortable doing it. Plus, if I can do it in Orlando, all better.
There's no better place to coach.
Listen, I'm going to tell you, I was in Dallas before I got traded here. Ernie Stott, my very first year. Ernie was a great coach. Said, go do what you do. We went to the Arena Bowl. We got beat by a team that brought in six NFL guys in the playoffs in Detroit. The following year, they brought in Drew Pearson. Drew Pearson is a wide receiver who knew nothing about the game and told me to my face that I wasn't going to run his franchise because I wasn't his kind of player. You read between the lines. So I ended up getting traded to Orlando halfway through the season. And when I got here, we were staying in a part of town that I had to sleep below the window line so that the bullets flying through didn't hit me. And I said, there is zero chance I'm coming back to Orlando. Zero. My head coach is like, no. He goes, listen, the ownership here is great. People are great. Blah, blah, blah. He goes, at least listen to me. I said, they got one shot. So I came back, made me an offer. I said, all right, I'll give it a 1 year. Give me a second year option. And I've been here ever since. So Orlando is it's a great city. People here are fantastic, as evidenced by most of the group here at Fish on Fire. And it's just, this is home for me. You know, whether I'm coaching somewhere else and coming back, I'll always call Orlando home.
You'll always be a son of a friend. You can't say Orlando Predators without mentioning Ben Bennett. You know, in there.
Well, and that's the way it should be, by now.
I know. Yeah. And I noticed that I read it somewhere that there's no conceit in your family.
No! It's all under one capsule.
And there's nothing wrong with that.
Listen, Dizzy Dean had a quote that I learned my freshman year at Duke. It ain't bragging if you can do it.
Yeah, it ain't bragging.
And, I mean, and that's the truth. If you say, listen, I'm going to go out, I'm going to hit two home runs today, and you go out and hit two home runs, that ain't bragging. Yeah, the one where the seeded really started sticking with me. Growing up in California, we set all sorts of state scoring records in high school. I called all my own plays. We kill everybody. I get to Duke. We go through the entire season, and I'm kind of doing the team thing as I always do. We got to an interview before the Carolina game, which is the last game of the year. Now, Carolina at this point is 9-1. They're ranked fourth in the country. The only team they lost to that year was Oklahoma. So they're Lawrence Taylor. They had five guys in their front seven drafted the first two rounds of the NFL draft. So I go through this big, long interview, and at the very end, he goes, well, what are your personal goals? I said, well, first of all, I'd like to win the ACC at least a couple of times before I get out. I said, I'd like to be named ACC Player of the Year at least a couple of times. I said, I'd like to throw for over 9,000 yards. Now, at that point, Mark Herman still hadn't set the NCAA record of over 9,000 yards at that point. My last quote was, and personally, I'd like to destroy Carolina. Now, all of the hours worth of quotes about the team and I care about Duke and the conference and the whole bit, none of that went into the article. It all came down to, I want to throw for 9,000 yards and I want to beat the crap out of Carolina. So that went on the bulletin boards and that's where it was. And I wasn't about to back down from it because I said it and I admit it. Now, I saved all of the article from every person that wrote something about being cocky, conceited, this, that, the other. As I hit the milestone that I said I would, and I was ACC Rookie of the Year, ACC Player of the Year twice, and I threw for 6 NCAA records, 15 ACC records, and 42 school records. As I reached every milestone, I would handwrite on the article, Love, Ben, and I would mail it to the guy that wrote the article. So, Dizzy Dean says the best, it ain't bragging if you can do it.
You know what, that's great. That's a great, I don't want to say slogan, but that's definitely a great thing to live by right there. Ain't bragging if you can do it. You heard that, right? It ain't bragging if you can do it. I know, it doesn't stop. You still know. So let's see here. Kelly McCabe has got a birthday today. Kelly is out there. Actually, her birthday was on Wednesday. Happy belated birthday, Kelly. You're welcome. I know Phil's in the house. Phil's coming on later on. Dick Jukowski's in the house. He's going to come on the show in a minute. And so is Alan Claw. So we'll be on the show.
Kelsky's here
today. I'm sorry?
When did you get out of the car?
Look at his ankle.
So a blue light flash on the bottom. I got it. It goes with the outfit, though, Nick. Let's get on.
It's a release. But if you folks have any more questions for Coach Bennett, please bring him in now. He's not leaving, but we're going to bring somebody else who stays here in just a minute. But do you have anything else that you want to throw out here?
Let's see.
Come on, man. Ain't bragging if you can do it.
That's true. I just realized we didn't talk about the bottle of goodness. That's the oxy. Yeah, that was good. A different kind of bottle, but a bottle of goodness that I used. It just set in. Now, listen, we enjoy coming out here every Monday night. This place, if you haven't been here, it's an absolute blast. Bartenders and waitresses all take really good care of you. There's a nice little clientele that comes up. Make sure you wish Carla a happy birthday on your way out. She's the one over by the corner of the bar giving away her cookies. But it's a good place. Take care of the people here. They'll take care of you. Hope to see you guys back. I'm going to go see what Jakilski's work release program is about. And thanks for having me.
Thanks for having us. I really appreciate it.
Hey, wait. This is where the thunderous round of applause comes in. That's what I'm talking about.
Everybody give a hand. He's got this nice little scar on his knee from the total knee replacement.
You see the pain that I fight through for this team? This team?
And he wants to go to Albany. He's not going to get any love in Albany like he does here in Orlando.
That cold weather is not good.
We play indoors.
Somebody out there said there's cold weather out there. Ben has to say, play indoor football. That's how it works. I'm going to throw it out there. I'm just going to do a little for on Facebook here. A clip for when we had the Orlando Press
Yankees in a way.
Signed this this season has not got to play the Miami Dolphins this weekend. So, I mean, good luck to Sean Payton. All right, so Sean Payton has got a lot of things to talk with the Dolphins this weekend. I mean, for his sake, I hope he makes it, you know, and does great. But on a selfish side, I want him back.
So, I don't like the Dolphins.
I don't really care.
But for his sake, I'd love to see him go. You know, there's a lot of guys that play arena football that, you know, have the hope of using this as a stepping stone, and that's definitely one of the benefits of arena league is playing outside of the other seasons, so you get your footage out there for them to see.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, you get out there. To move up again, and what you love to do. I lost my pen here, and there it is. Let's see if anything starts. I'm not even getting any comments on here. I don't know what I'm doing here. But, and listen, just to remind everybody, all right, because since we first started doing Bread Talk, we've got more and more people calling us, getting you on each show. Tell us a little bit about yourself again. Just remind the fans. Where are you from?
Originally, I'm from New Jersey. I grew up there my whole life. I moved to Florida at the beginning of 2017. I started kicking probably the summer before freshman year of high school. Basically taught myself off a magazine article from Adam Vinatieri that was in Sports Illustrated. And then I just loved it. I fell in love with that. I used to play wide receiver and cornerback, but those are the two most popular positions. So instead of, you know, having to compete with all these guys in high school, other than the senior kicker who had one more season before I graduated, I said, you know, hey, you know, there's nobody else going out for this, so I'm going to go for this spot. And then, you know, I stuck with that, and then I played the year of junior college afterwards, Lackawanna College, which is one of the best junior college programs in the country. Mark Duna, our head coach, is one of the most winningest coaches. You know, he played for the Cardinals back in the NFL. Those guys still are successful, but it was all D1 caliber guys that just either didn't have the grades or whatnot. They played a year or two there and they moved on. And then I played a little semi-pro football a couple of years in New Jersey before I moved to. And I would visit because my mom had lived here before I moved down. So I went to a couple of Predators games before I even lived in Florida, and you know, I fell in love with arena football. The first arena football game I ever went to was a Columbus game in Ohio. And this is early 2000s, and you know, that was the first time actually seeing an indoor football field. And I thought it was awesome because it's, you're so up close and personal, it's faster paced. And then once I moved here, you know, the Predators had already pulled in. And as soon as the news came out that they were starting back up again, I immediately started training again and tried out. And I actually got to try out in front of Mark Lewis. He evaluated us, me and another kicker there at the tryouts, which I thought was awesome. Because, you know, Mark Lewis.
If you're a Predator fan, you know who Mark Lewis is.
Yeah. I mean, a ton of other teams. I know he's played for other teams, but, you know, when you think of kicker for arena football, you think of Mark Lewis. So outside of football, I'm also a firefighter and an EMT. I've been doing that for 11 years now. And that's why I like playing here in Orlando, because I live here. It gives me the opportunity to still have my normal job and normal life, and then also play for the same community that I live in. So I really don't have any interest or to go anywhere else or play for anybody else. I'm a Predators fan before I was a player. I'm just going to say that.
That's good. I mean, I'm glad to have you back. I like you. You're nice. I say a nice kid. That's because I'm old. But yeah, you're a nice kid. You're always very polite. And you can get the shit out of football. That's the best part right there. Now, I haven't seen your mom on here once in a while, because your mom always would watch Carolyn
personally, I would love to have the Nets back. You know, it's the Deuce. I would love to have the Deuce and keep the Nets. I think if the combination of the two would just make the game keep that fast pace. And you know, because the Deuce, everybody loves Deuce. It keeps this extra way to score. It gets the fans hyped. You know, everybody loves seeing the ball looking the uprights. But the only problem is, if you miss it, they're basically at midfield, and in arena football, you know, 9 times out of 10, if you start at midfield, unless you force a turnover, they're going to score. So I like having the four balls because,
like, you what?
Four balls.
Sorry.
So when on kickoff and
you
the
did
ball.
Say bar balls, right?
Yep, bar balls. So kickoff and the bar goes off of the iron from the nets. Bounces off the kickers, everybody calls that a bar ball.
Okay.
And that's like.
Glad you clarified.
Yeah. That's even actually, in my opinion, and probably a bunch of other kickers, those are more valuable than deuces because you have the opportunity to either get the ball and score or get the ball and then have the offense come in and score and then score a touchdown as opposed to just 2 points.
Dickie, I want to put a comment on that. A comment, not a question. Dickie thinks I'm a server. He says, have Morgan make me some work to be there in 30 minutes. So, okay, there you go, Nikki. Morgan, make Dickie some work. Okay.
Ordering in.
I didn't know I was the ordering guy. Yeah. But that's okay, that's all right. Let's see. All right. Tammy, good question, Tammy. When is the Omaha Store going to be up and running? That is such a great question. I sound like the commissioner. That is a great question.
Never a bad question.
No. But I will tell you this. We're having a meeting tomorrow with a merchandising company that is going to try and fill all of our needs at the very lowest and cheapest price. Believe me, we want nothing more than to get merchandise and open up an online store so that you, fans, Greg Myers, you can get your jersey, you can get all your stuff. Trust me, I've not forgotten about you folks. I hate bringing it up because it sounds like I'm saying the same thing over and over and over again. But we are working on the online store, okay? It won't be long, put it that way. From what I understand, once we strike a deal with this company, once we put the order in, 14 days later we have it. So hopefully it will be, before the end of September, put it that way. All right? I mean, that's giving me a long goal, but it's not up to me. I'm the middleman here. I saw on Facebook that you were with the new sheriff elect over in, was it Volusia County?
Osceola.
In Osceola County, and he gave you a job. What was that? Was it? You were like an honorary deputy?
No, so Marco Lopez won the primary. And so now, obviously, he has to go in the general election in November. We're not very independent, but it's a Democratic county. Usually, the Democratic candidate always wins, so we're pretty hopeful. But yeah, I was helping him with the election there, and he was the underdog. The other two guys, it was the city sheriff and another guy, and they both had the big $100,000 to spend campaign, and we didn't have those funds. We did old school door knocking, sign waving. Osceola County, I believe, has like 45 openings, and his thing is that when he gets in, he's looking for good guys to bring in, trying to fill those spots. So I definitely would love to make the switch to go and continue to do public safety, but kind of do something else. So I'm trying to find a way where I can still do fire things, but we'll see. That might be a lot of fun.
Let me ask you, I mean, this is your not counting the 2020 season, this will be your what? Not counting the 2020, this will be your second year in the NBA, correct? What do you think, what are your opinions on what has been going on in the past 2 weeks what's going on. No. I mean, you're a player, so you know what do you think?
I love it. The NAL is definitely doing a lot of things behind the scenes. It's up and coming. You know, for the longest time, the IFL was really like the big league other than the AFL, and I think we're starting to see a shift now. But the NAL is starting to come up, and I really like kind of the way the NAL, the daily operations are, game day operations. You know, it's a new league, so obviously there was just some stuff to fix here and there. But I mean, the commissioner and our owners are, I mean, as well as, you know, Rob Storm and the other owners.
You know how you do it? Rob Storm's nasty, didn't show up tonight. That's all right.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of the Shark Tank, but Rob Storm is a good owner. These guys, unlike maybe some of these other leagues, these fly by night leagues that pop up and fold, these guys they have the commitment. You know, they want to be involved with football and not just own a football team. They want to make sure the league survives, which is great. And you know, as a player, you want to know that if you're playing for a league, you're playing for a team. There's security of, you know, you don't want to be in a league that's going to fold halfway through the season. So, and so knowing Ron and Nate personally, it's hard to not comment on social media because I might know some things that haven't been released yet. I see all the comments, and I'm like, I want to answer, but I'm like, no, it's better. Yeah, I'll just wait for that to let the surprise happen. But Albany is great. Albany has a great following. It always has. It's one of those venues and markets like Orlando and Tampa and Jacksonville. Baltimore.
West Virginia
would be cool. We've had the Rough Riders out. So
we got the West Virginia Rough Riders.
But you know, interesting about that is the NAL now has three champions? Yeah, you have Albany, who won the championship in the AFL.
Albany,
you have the
Rough Riders,
who won the championship in the AAL, and then you have our champions, and they're all in the same league. So now you have three top teams all in the same league now, which is awesome.
We have a lot of talent coming into the NAL. Not just different teams, but a lot of different players, you know, that are coming in. Because the AFL folded, so these players still want to play. They still want to move up. They still want to, you know, compete. And that's what it's all about.
Absolutely.
And there's no better place than to come into the NAL. Especially for the East Coast. You know, especially for the East Coast. Now, there was a lot of different things out there on Facebook, and I'll bring it up. I'm not scared. I'll bring it up. I know the Massachusetts Pirates went to the IFL. That's pretty much West Coast. Into West Coast. I personally think they're making a mistake. I've never heard that, but hey, listen, that's
logistically, it's always going to be hard.
On paper, it doesn't look feasible. But hey, look, more power to them. Good luck to them. I think once their contract runs out, they're going to come back to the NBA now. Because we're not going anywhere.
I wouldn't be surprised if before this season or before the season following, if we were up at 12 teams with the amount of things going on in the background. You know, I know the ownership of Baltimore canceled out, but I still think Baltimore still has potential in the future for a different team. You know, and I've heard, right now I'm not going to name any names, but I've heard of at least two other areas where they're right now in discussion of bringing in teams. So, you know, in a matter of less than a year, we could possibly, you know, go from, you know, a handful of teams to 12. So.
Do you know something that we don't know? You want to give us some insight on something? You know?
No.
Because I've been out of town from Thursday to Tuesday. I was out of town. I didn't hear all this juicy gossip that maybe you got. You know? I had to leave town.
Ron's looking out.
He's checking you out. We're like, watch what you say if you want to kick football again. are silly questions. They're not to be serious. And if you could gain the ability to time travel, what's the first place you would go to?
Oh man, there's so many.
And don't say Rachel's 2 weeks ago, alright? That's just not gonna work.
There's so many things.
You want to come back to it?
No. I'm a big history guy, so I would love to see something very important in history. Now, are we able to interfere or just view something like that?
Listen, this is your bed. If you want to travel back in time and you want to stop Abraham Lincoln from getting shot, I mean, you know, that's your prerogative. This is your little bigger thing. It's just my question.
Maybe go back to go meet like George Washington himself.
To meet George Washington.
Back in the 1700s.
I gotta tell you, ever since then, that was the hardest bullet to get that answer out of you.
There's so many places you can go back and see the Big Bang. You can go back and meet Jesus. You can so many different people and things to do.
Meet George Washington. Good for you. I do have another one here. If you could wake up tomorrow with a new ability, what would you want that ability to do?